Okay, thank you so much for the time, and I'm sorry for the delay. Okay, so welcome everybody to Maranatha, although virtually. So I'm going to start my presentation about the triplets of Indonesian private law. Let me share the screen first. Okay, hopefully it's visible now. If it's not, please kindly tell me. So this is because I'm from the Faculty of Law, so I hope that most of you already informed with about the pluralistic legal system of Indonesia. So first, I think we already know some facts. Let me just jump into some of those facts, which would be relevant for the next information that I would give you. The first would be that Indonesia is occupied by Dutch, the Netherlands, for 350 years. Well, not exactly 350 years. If you count it exactly, it's 340 years. And by the way, the first two centuries of it was, the fact is that Indonesia was occupied not by the Netherlands, not by the Dutch, but for the two and a half centuries at the first years, actually we occupied by Verenigde Oost-Indie Company. Perhaps you know it in English by Dutch East Indies Company. That's the first multinational corporation in the world. And during the World War II, the Japanese invaded and occupied Indonesia only 3.5 years, but something which is noteworthy because during those times, I mean 3.5 years compared to 3.5 centuries, that would make big difference, wouldn't it? And the next thing is that populations of Indonesia comprises about 275 million, and Indonesia is known for being 14th most populated country in the world after China, India, and United States. Yeah, for but we have quite very populated country, and Indonesia is the most largest country, and we comprised with mostly with islands, and we have 17 islands, and that is why actually we have you'll know that we have the compulsory law, what we called as adat or customary law, which is actually different from one big island to another. Well, we have 17,000 islands, but we only have like around six major groups of island. And the island of Java, the island where Maranatha is situated, with the over 140 million people, is the most populous island in the world. We have so many people. And with the variety of flora and fauna, Indonesia is second into the world after Brazil, with the highest level of biodiversity in the world. And Indonesia is known for being the mega diverse, which means that we have a numbers of species, which is very special, that you cannot find it in another part of the world. Well, the same goes with the culture. The next thing is, despite of being one of the G20 of world's leading economics, we have some of the populations which has incomes less than $2 per day. So we are very diverse here. I mean, in the terms of income. And the next would be that the name Indonesia is derived from the word Indus, that means India, Indian, and Nesos, which means island. So we always thought that we were the same with India. That explains why the symbol of Indonesia is Garuda Pancasila. Perhaps some of you have already known about it. And Garuda Pancasila, actually, that is originated from India mythology. If you already knew, and if you know the music of Indonesia, we call it dangdut. Yeah, dangdut is the rhythm. In some ways, is also it also has similarities. To a certain extent, with Indian musics, but it doesn't. I don't mean that we are exactly alike like India, but the origin. I mean, the name of Indonesia. I think there must be a reason for that. So the next would be that Muslims make up about 72.2% of Indonesian population, which makes the world's largest Muslim majority nation. But until now, we are not a Muslim country. Until now, and I mean, according to the constitution, that's what we can conclude. Jakarta, which was called Batavia by the Dutch, is the capital of Indonesia and the 13th largest city in the world. And the word ketchup in English comes from Indonesian word ketchup. Yeah. So the tomato sauce, I mean, we call it tomato sauce. Yeah. But English, in English, it's always thought as a ketchup. And ketchup happens to originate it from Indonesian word, which is sweet soy sauce. Yeah. And of course, you can guess that that sweet soy sauce in Indonesia has other meaning. Yeah. Although those both of them are still food ingredients. And Indonesian government recognizes only 6 religions, and Islam, Hinduism, Protestantism, Catholicism, and Confucianism. And every Indonesian citizen must belong to one of those religions, regardless of what they believe. And to individuals of different religions may not legally married, and one of them should convert. Well, I have to say, this is the common knowledge. Actually, if you see the legal backgrounds in Indonesia, there is one colonial regulations. I mean, the regulations which already prevails from the colonial period until now. And it hasn't been repealed yet until now. And according to the regulations, we can marry mixedly. I mean, mixed marriage is something which is applicable in Indonesia, but because some of us are very heavily predominantly dominated by the current prevailing marriage law in Indonesia, which was from law number 1 year 1974 in Indonesia, that is why many people in Indonesia thought that mixed marriage is something which is not acceptable in Indonesia. But why should we talk about Indonesian private law? Why not criminal law? Well, the first reason is criminal law has been uniform by the applicability by the applicability of criminal code in Indonesia, which is actually originated from webbook Van Straffre. There is a law that is originated from from the penal code of Napoleon Bonaparte. Yes, you are not wrong, you are completely right. The second thing is the only territory which is different in Indonesia, so where our criminal code is not applicable, that would be Aceh. Yeah, perhaps you already are familiar, that's the most territory in Indonesia, the most east, almost the eastern, I mean the eastern and the top of Indonesia, where the special regulations of Sharia law is applicable in Aceh. Yeah, so it's what applied there is called kanun. Kanun is actually laws. Kanun is like regulations, and jinayat or the criminal law of Muslims or of Sharia law is applicable in Aceh. Okay, so that is why I didn't discuss about, I mean, I don't discuss about private law. That's the reason. So now we are trying to explain first, what do I mean by the triplets here? What are the triplets of the Indonesian private, Indonesian private law? What I mean here is not that the triplets are born at the same time, but actually they coexist at the same time until now. Okay, so they at least they are not born in the same time, in the means that, yeah, I mean they're not even originated from the same place. First, because the only law that is originated from Indonesia is that adat and customary law. And because Indonesia has so many islands, that is why we can understand why there are so much diversity even in laws. Why? Because the situations, I mean, during those times, there wouldn't be transportation which allow us to move from one place to another. That is why adat and customary law, it's very, very, it's based on the territory of each island. The next would be Islamic law. We already know that Islamic law is the last religion to come to Indonesia. The first would be Hinduism, and then Buddhism, and then Catholics, Protestant, and the last would be, it's not the last, because we have six. Then after Islam, we have Confucianism. But actually Confucianism, you can also confuse it, because on history, usually it's always attached to Buddhism also. Because I mean it's always related to the coming of the Indian and Gujarat and also Chinese diaspora to Indonesia. That's what's attached to the Buddhism and Hinduism history their coming to Indonesia. So the next thing that will be the national law, which actually derived from the Dutch colonial, but we'll go to the details of three of this. First would be the adat or the customary law. Perhaps some of you already familiar with Van Vollenhoven. Van Vollenhoven legacy, Van Vollenhoven is called as the principal actor of the preservation of adat law in Indonesia. Why? First, because he is the first to define the difference between adat or customary law and Islamic law. Why? Because in Indonesia, there are some theorists, I will talk about it later in the next slides, that adat law is sometimes confused with Islamic law. But Van Vollenhoven is very strict about it. He said that adat law is not Islamic law. Islamic law is not adat law. The second thing is that Van Vollenhoven then defend adat law from any efforts to negate the existing of the adat law. We can guess perhaps some of governments, the colonial, they prefer to have a more simple regulations, and it would be easier if adat law is attached to Islamic law. Then you would just talk about one law, and that's more simple for the existing government during those times. But Van Vollenhoven said no, it's not the same. So because it's not the same, then adat law should be preserved even from Islamic law. I mean, it's preserved. What I mean preserving here is that to admit that it exists and that its role in the society and that it is applicable in the society. And the third would be divide Indonesia to 19 adat milieu. For some of you who probably has ever visited Indonesia, especially the island of Java, you will familiar with the fact that even though Java Island is a whole island, but actually we are divided into at least two. You can see here that I mentioned about Jawa Barat. That would be the place of where Maranatha is situated, West Java province. And this is Jateng, that's from Central Java. This is an abbreviation, Jawa Tengah, Central Java. And Jawa Timur, that's also an abbreviation, East Java, and Madura. That's actually, if you can see it, this is Java Island. So this is where Maranatha is situated here. And this is Madura. So Madura actually is a separate island from Java, but it has a relation, so I mean they are so attached, so that it's kind of like, you know, they're having a different culture. So the first would be the Jawa Barat, that would be the first here, I think around here, yeah, there will be Jawa Barat and Jakarta. And the next is Jateng, Central Java, East Java, and Madura. So that is actually something which is precisely known in Indonesia, that there are differences to those areas. To those areas, they have the different culture and they have different laws too. Yeah. For example, in the past, there are prohibition for Sundanese men not to marry a Javanese, which I mean Javanese is Jawa Tengah and Jawa Timur. So they are not allowed to marry the Javanese women. Why? Well, it has something to do with the history. I wouldn't talk too much about it, but that's about the history. Now you can guess why there are 19 adat milieu or 19 in adult environment that is stated by Van Vollenhoven in his theory. Yeah, why? Because even though it's in the same island, they have different situations, which makes that, I'm not the same as you. Okay, now the next thing, the second point, would be the Islamic or Sharia law. For the Dutch, they previously know the Sharia law as the Mohammedan's law. Yeah, it's of course related to the name of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Sources of the application of Sharia laws in Indonesia, I think most of you already know that there are two primary sources, Al-Quran and also Al-Sunnah, and the secondary sources, which is Ijma' Ulama and also Qiyas. Well, that is just to simplify anyway. Actually, there are some others, which is Ijma, Maslaha, Satzaria, Urf, and Siyasas. The things that usually in regular faculty of law, especially in terms of faculty of law in Maranatha, we don't go deeply too much on Sharia laws. Why? Because we have to speak about Indonesia, and Sharia laws is a part of Indonesia. To the terms of national private law. So the next thing would be the Islamic law, Islamic finance law. And Islamic finance law is, I wouldn't go too much on it, but this is something which is emerging in Indonesia also. And this is something which is developed rapidly in Indonesia. And it has also a legal basis on it. I mean, we have some regulations of economic Sharia law, muamalah, but we learn it in the faculty of law, but only at the, I mean, it's I mean, not very much, because this is part of the Indonesian law, but again, it's something which is only part of Indonesia. I mean, we have adat law, we have Islamic law, and we also have the last one, that would be the national law. Oh, by the way, we have to see this slide also. If we talk about Sharia law, that would be about the worship and the general transaction, and what we are trying to discuss here, that's about the general transactions, which comprises munakahat and muamalah and jinayat. I already mentioned about jinayat, and that's the one that is applicable in Aceh about bodily harm. If you steal something and you would get the sanction, I wouldn't go deep on it, but that's just an example. And the next thing, that would be munakahat and muamalah. We are trying to remember about these things. Yeah, I mean, the one that we learn in the faculty is muamalah. That's about civil and commercial law of the Islamic law. And Indonesia, actually, we have the family law also, which is stated in the in the presidential instruction number 1, year 1991, concerning Islamic law compilation, which I already told you that although majority of Indonesians are Muslims, Indonesia is not an Islamic country. So I don't know why the exact reasons, but Suharto, during his presidency, only allows that the legal grounds of Islamic law application in Indonesia is only by the president the presidential instruction number 1 year 1991. That's concerning Islamic law compilation. But I think you have to know that the Islamic law compilation comprises family laws. So the law of inheritance, the law of the relations between the families. What I mean families is here first about, of course, first about the marriage, and then about the who will be the legal child. And remember that Islamic law actually does not admit any foster child because it has no blood relation to the parents. So there is no inheritance which is implicated from that relation. That is why actually there are some differences between the Islamic law that is applicable in Saudi Arabia and the one that is applicable in Indonesia. Although there are not too much difference, there are slight differences on it. For example, the one that I told you just now about the foster child, because according to Islamic law, there is no inheritance at all. I mean, the Islamic law, which is from Saudi Arabia. But in Indonesia, even foster child also has the right to inherit the properties that were that are owned by their foster parents. So it's slightly different on that point. And muamalah or civil and commercial law are emerging in Indonesia in terms of Sharia economic law. Yeah, economic Sharia law. Well, yeah, you can say the other way around. Between the adat and Islamic law, I already told you that I will go for this. That is something which is conditio sine qua non, something which is inevitable. That are the facts of Indonesia which cannot be avoided in any terms. That is why actually there are some conflicts or some controversies between legal experts on the coexistence of the adat law and Islamic law in Indonesia. The first would be the theory of receptio in complexu. They said that religious law has been accepted by local society. So in short, religious law replaced adat law. So adat law is no longer exist and religious law is the one which exists in Indonesia. But this theory is something I have already told you about Van Vollenhoven. Van Vollenhoven and Snow Kurgronje, they offer a theory of reception, in English, reception theory. So religion laws, according to Van Vollenhoven, only prevails when there is no conflict with local adat law. So in other words, local adat law is higher here. Speaking about which one is higher to the other, I think this is the most sensitive for Indonesian Muslims. That is why Professor Hazairin and Professor Sayuti Talib then offers a new theory of receptio a contrario theory, that adat law prevails when there is no conflict with the religious law. So here, religious law is considered higher than the adat law. Well, this is something which is, I think, remain unresolved until now. I mean, Indonesia do not stand on the we do not stand on that one law is higher to another. I mean, which one law is dominant to another. So we don't conclude that. Perhaps the because we just accept the fact that that is the conditions in Ekwanon of Indonesia. Well, although a little bit hard, I mean a little bit hard, I think there is something which is also rational in my head. Why? Because Indonesia is so pluralistic. That is why I think it would be better for us just to say that, okay, we accept difference. We know that there is added law. We know that there is Islamic law. And they just coexist. Not to conclude which one is higher than to the other. So the next thing, we go to the third point, that would be the national law. And the national law, which is actually not a national one, because it derives from Dutch colony. In the past, when Indonesia was an East India, when Indonesia was considered as a part of Netherlands India, the applicable constitution was Indische Staatsregeling. So in that constitution, yeah, let me say it that way, okay? In that constitution, there are two articles which is very important even until now. There are two articles, that is Article 131 and 163. 163 divides the citizens of Netherlands Indië into three classifications: European citizens, including Japan and South Africa, yeah, because their family laws is considered the same as European. Well, I don't know, in the sense of Japan, why they make this classifications. Yeah, perhaps because Japan wants were I think he they once win the war to Russia, but that is why Japan is not considered as the part of Asia, by the way. I mean, in this sense. And the second would be the Far Eastern foreign citizens, including Arabic, Chinese, Indian, Pakistani, and Egyptian. Well, for this, let me just stop with the classification of citizens. The third would be the indigenous citizens. Yeah, we called it, they call it Bumi Putra. So it's the same as you find it in Malaysia, Bumi Putra. That refers to indigenous indigenous Indonesians. This is why, actually, in the first place, why we always think about who is the foreign and who is the indigenous. This is related because of the fact when the Dutch during its occupation divide our nation into three classes. And in Article 131, actually there are different legal systems which is applicable to those three classification of citizens. The first is would be the one that would be applied to them, that is the European or Dutch law. That is applicable to all of them. And for the second, there are differences. For the family law and also civil and commercial matters, the European and Dutch law is applicable. But for some parts of it, I mean, I mistyped it. For the family law, their customary law is the one which is applicable. Yeah. The next thing would be the indigenous citizen. What law is applicable to them? That would be the adat or the Islamic law. This is why, in the first place, because in the second classification, that would be for Eastern and foreign citizens, there are some parts of Indonesian indigenous also, which is included in that in the second classification, and that would be the Christian indigenous. Only in the terms of family law. So for civil and commercial matters, for Indonesian Christians, the adat law and Islamic law is still applicable. But for the family law, the one that is applicable is the Dutch law, is the European law. So during the Japanese occupation in Indonesia, we know that all prevailing applicable law, when the Japanese army is coming to Indonesia, will still prevail. So let's say during those 3.5 years, there are no big difference because Netherlands Indy is still abide by the Dutch law, not the Japanese law. This is to make it precise to you that Japanese leaves no legacy on its occupation in the sense of legal system. And Indonesian independence for the Article 2 and transitional regulations in 1945 Constitution. This is Indonesia proclaimed its independence on 17 August, and the day after that, we ratified the applicability of our constitutions. That's 1945 Constitution, and the transitional regulation stated that all prevailing regulation is still applicable. All prevailing body is still applicable, even until now. So until 2006, classification of citizens in Article 163 in Indonesia Staatsregeling, the constitution which is applicable when Indonesia was parts of Netherlands, the article is still applicable, at least Article 163. So you can see the proof by seeing the birth certificates. Our birth certificates, which was registered or issued before 2006, you can see that it always mentioned the basis of classification of citizens in Indonesian law. Mm-hmm. Oh, really? Yes. They mentioned the regulation exactly. And that actually implicates to the fact that what kind of law are we abide to? Are we abide in? So why 2006? Because on that year, there was an enactment of law on nationality of Indonesia and also law on citizenship administration, which revoke all the classification of citizens in Indonesia. So practically Article 163 ES is not applicable legally. However, the things that I should have told, I have to tell you that the remaining classifications of law is, remember, 163 is about the classification of citizens. So that is no longer applicable. But 131 IS, Article 131 IS, is never revoked until now. So it's still applicable. Yeah, it's still applicable. So the remaining classification of law, Yeah, so there is no longer classification of citizens in Indonesia right now, but there are still remaining classifications of law in Indonesia right now. Yeah, especially for the terms of inheritance disputes. Why? Because if there is no Article 131 IS, it would be very complicated to solve the inheritance dispute in Indonesia if we don't have the Article 131. Then we wouldn't know to whom which law would be applicable to whom. That is why, although the citizenship classification is no longer applicable, but the classification of law is still applicable to certain extent, at least in the inheritance field. So perhaps you hear about the private law, the national private law, which is derived derived from the colonial era, that would be Burgerlijk Wetboek or Civil Code of Netherlands Indië. Yeah, this Burgerlijk Wetboek is still applicable in Indonesia right now, especially for Cindo, Chinese Indonesian. Why? Because remember, Chinese Indonesian is included in the second classification, and fourthly for Christian Indigenous. But the rest of it, it's also still applicable. By what? By voluntary submission. This is a little bit. Why voluntary submission? This is because we have four books in Burgerlijk Wetboek, that's the civil code. The first book is about family law. This is only applicable for the person who's having Christian religions or having their family law the same with the Dutch law. And the second would be the law of property, Zakenrecht. And the third would be the law of obligation. So law of obligations comprises the part of law on contracts, yeah, law of contracts, and law of tort, yeah, law of tort and law of contracts. So law of contracts, law of tort, and law of property that will be applicable to any of Indonesians, but not based on automatic application, but it's based on submission or voluntary submission of Indonesian nationals to the Burgerlijk Wetboek. Why I have to state this? Because actually most of foreigners are misunderstood, saying that the only private law that is applicable in Indonesia is only Burgerlijk Wetboek. Well, no, that is only a part of Indonesia. If we're speaking about Indonesia, then we would speak about three different laws, yeah, especially applicable. This would be the last slide of my points. So yeah, let me conclude this. First, Indonesia's private law system is applicable now. There are some facts that we have to realize about this. First, that Indonesian private legal system is still pluralistic until now. And civil law is based on the Burgerlijk Wetboek, yeah, while there are also other laws that are applicable in Indonesia, and that's customary and Islamic law. Yeah, those three laws coexist in Indonesia. We have the confluence, and it's still applicable in Indonesia until now. And the existence of Islamic law that will be proven, I mean, that's the proof of the existence of Islamic law. That's the compilation of Islamic law, that the one that I told you, it was enacted by the presidential instruction number 1 year 1991. And the last would be the existence of customary law. Article 18B of 1945 Constitution that states recognize and respects customary law community and also their traditional rights as long as they are still alive and in accordance with the development of society and the principles of the unitary Republic of Indonesia, which are regulated by law. And by the way, this is just to tell you some introduction to it. Yeah, perhaps you are interested with this fact. Actually, Indonesia is now working on a bill on added law society. So perhaps it seems that the most likely in the future there will be more recognition to added law in Indonesia after the enactment of bill on added law society. So the last would be the application of those three legal systems goes hand in hand in Indonesia until now. And perhaps this is also, perhaps our internal complexity sometimes prevents Indonesia to be involved in more for the global problems. That is why if you see the opinions on foreign scholars on Indonesian legal systems, they would say sometimes Indonesia doesn't really put attention to the public international and the private international. But as for this, I think we have made so much improvements on this. First, because now public international law I think they preserve more recognition in Indonesia now. And we are now actually doing on bill and on private international law. Private international law. And actually I am a part of that private international law team in the interministerial government committee, which we are doing the bill on private international law. And if it's already in the national legislation, and hopefully, if anything goes right, I think on 2024, I think it would be enacted. So, best of luck for Indonesia. Okay, I think most of all, I think that's my point. Thank you for listening, and if you have questions, I'm very welcome to it. Thank you so much, for the committee, I think I will give the time and the place to you. Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you so much for the material, Ms. Tesnawati. It's really interesting, and I think all the participants will feel the same about the incredible material delivery that you already served for us today. So,
for now, there will be a little Q&A session. So if any one of you guys want to ask something or make sure about any details in your materials today, you can ask it right away or turn on your mic or chat in the chat box.
Okay, maybe any participant will give your opinion. Maybe Ms. Tasnawati can choose our participant to give their opinion.
Okay. thank you for the opportunity. Well, I see that most of the participants comes from China and Philippines. Okay. Once when I was I finished my degree in my master degree in University of Groningen in Netherlands, and one of the issue that was stated about the Indonesian private law, a lot of Chinese friends were asking about there are three questions of the private international law. The first would be, what would the jurisdictions applicable in Indonesia, the jurisdictions applicable for any private international disputes. The second would be the law applicable for any private international disputes, and the third would be the recognition and enforcement of foreign judgment. So some of my because I think because in my classes during those times there are only Chinese and one Indonesian, that will be me, there are some questions about the recognition and enforcement of foreign judgment in Indonesia. So I think Philippines also having the same problems with us. That is, we don't have the basis of recognition and enforcement of foreign judgment in Indonesia. According to the Article 436 of RV, that would stands for Reglements Rechtsverordening, that's also from Dutch colonial until now. That is why in the first place we want to amend it to something which is more modern in this year. I mean, we hope that it will be enacted on 2024. The prevailing law still say that we cannot enforce any foreign judgment in Indonesia. Well, as far from the doctrine, I mean, based on Indonesian doctrine, Indonesian scholars say that, actually recognition is possible, but it's only for the decision which is not condemning. How to say it? I remember the Dutch words, but I don't remember the English words. I'm sorry, it's just mixed up in my head. So we all condemnatory decisions. We cannot accept the condemnatory decisions, but if it is only declaration decisions, then it would be applicable. That is something which is stated by our scholars, that's Yahya Harahap, one of Indonesian prominent judges. Yeah, one of Indonesian prominent judge, and also I think Professor Sudargo Gautama also said the same thing about the about those things. So actually, in that's all that I can say, that Indonesia currently haven't had any grounds on the recognition and enforcement, but hopefully in the next 2 or 3 years we would ratify the Hague Convention on the recognition and enforcement of foreign judgment. But it would be, I think it would be the next project after the private international law, which is now is a bill, is enacted around 2024. So let's just hope for it, our fingers crossed.
So Ms. Tresna, Mr. Billy said in the chat box, do you mind sharing your thoughts about how the arbitrary court solved the case of the private legacy warisan ownership dispute?
Well, inheritance or warisan dispute is not a jurisdiction of arbitration. So basically, in arbitrations, you can only solve civil and commercial cases. But the civil one is not included inheritance, because the civil, especially the family law, like divorce, I want to divorce and then I go to the arbitration. No. Why? Because there are some parts which is some parts of the family law, especially about the marriage law, which is actually has the public sides of it. I mean, you can marry to your spouse in front of the local institutions, but if you don't register it, then it's not publicly known, it's not applicable in Indonesia, so you have to register it. Perhaps you are also, because you are from Indonesia, perhaps you know about the nikah siri and its differences with the legal marriage in Indonesia. If it is a legal marriage, then it should be registered. But for the for nikah siri, that's you marry only in front of religious authorities, that would be, I mean, there is something legal according to your religion or the religion of the spouse or of those spouse, but it's not something which is legal in front of Indonesian government, of course we can conclude that as long as it's not registered, then it's not applicable in Indonesia. It's not applicable. So because you were asking about the inheritance may only resolve through courts. You cannot pick arbitration for that. You cannot pick arbitration for that. So the only remaining resolution is through the court. Why? Because inheritance always involves, let's say, the the land and also other kind of properties. For any movable properties, then there wouldn't be any problem for it. But for land, there is always a public site to it. I mean, let's say for the land, even the jurisdictions which would be applicable to the case about the land, that would be the place or the court where the land is situated. So there is no choice for a land because there is interest of the country, interest of that state to rule over the land that is situated in their jurisdictions. So there is no other alternatives to the court in case of inheritance. I think that's more than I can say. And thank you for the question. Yeah, unofficial marriage. Yeah. Sorry. If I make you surprised because of my style, I'm sorry. Yes. But the unofficial marriage, you cannot solve it. If there is any dispute on that, you also cannot solve it through the arbitration. That will be court would be the only alternatives. I think that's all that I can say. Thank you so much.
Okay, everyone still have any question? Maybe? Okay. I think there's no more questions, so thank you so much for the explanation, Ms. Presnawati. It's such as an impressive material, but unfortunately, we have limited time.
Thank you so much for the opportunity. It is very precious.